l'impression que j'ai à peu près autant de monde que dans la première session. Alors là, on va aborder un sujet qui est un peu plus économique, un peu plus technique. On a vu dans la session précédente le fonctionnement des institutions et le rôle de l'Union européenne à travers des exemples concrets. Et maintenant, on va se pencher sur le plan de relance européen. Est-ce que, juste d'emblée, est-ce que vous pouvez me dire, lever la main ou me dire, est-ce qui a entendu parler du plan de relance européen ? Alors, je ne sais pas si tout le monde, j'ai endormi tout le monde dans la première session, ou si c'est un manque de... On ne fait pas bien notre travail à Paris en essayant de communiquer sur le plan de relance européen. Donc on va commencer. Et je fais comme ça. Alors je pense que ces images vous disent quelque chose. Février 2020, un virus attaque un peu la planète, y compris nos pays. Personne ne comprend, des crises dans les hôpitaux, des gens meurent, on ne comprend pas bien pourquoi. Les États membres sont un peu démunis sur la façon dont on doit réagir. Ah, pardon. Pour tout vous dire, to say it all, I spent my whole working life in English. 1 year ago, I came back to France and I had really to force myself to speak in French, and now I can't switch back to English. So, remember, February 2020, a major health crisis hits our continent together with the whole world. People die in the hospitals, hospitals are overwhelmed. Member states react in very different ways. Nobody has a clue on how to stop that virus. And in a matter of weeks, the whole EU is disorganized, borders are closed, people are confined in their homes, and the economy is stopped with a major drop in economic activity. And nobody has really a clue on how to address that new challenge. And that's where, quite quickly, member states agree that a common response at EU level will be more effective than a disorganized response. As I explained in the first session, EU only intervenes when things cannot be better done at national level. So in a very reactive way, the first step of the reaction was to address the health crisis, trying to limit the exchanging ideas and methods to limit the spread of the virus, ensure the provision of medical equipment, launch and support all efforts to find vaccines or treatments. All these are areas where the EU add value. And I think this is very important because to put some context to this health crisis management reaction at EU level, health was typically the type of areas where member states felt that it was their own competence. And there was very little role for the EU to deal with health policy. But suddenly, facing a common virus, a common health threat that doesn't care about borders, EU member states agree to join forces. So that's why the EU intervened in all these areas, including fighting disinformation, also helping EU citizens stranded abroad coming back to the continent, and then in the last step, and that I will spend more time on it, addressing the economic consequences. But maybe you were not aware, but there were a lot of decisions put on the table that helped addressing this all these areas. I will come back on it. Then the second step was to address the economic impact of closing borders, of closing companies, keeping people in their homes. The immediate impact was a drop of 7.4% in the EU GDP. And there was a common need in all member states to keep companies alive and to support people and keep them in their jobs. We could not afford collectively to have all companies going bankrupt and people losing their jobs. So there was, we also closed borders, which meant that the single market was at risk. Goods could not circulate well between countries. We had difficulties importing goods from abroad. And our economies are so interlinked that any disorganized response would have consequences for each member state. We also, in addressing the economic consequences of this crisis, we also learned the lessons from the 2008-2009 financial crisis, where the continent was hit with a similar economic shock, not with the same origin, and where the EU response was not the right one. That is, in 2008, there was no solidarity between member states to put money together and support the economy. So each member state went with their own tools. And while, for instance, just to give you an example, in the 2008 crisis, Germany activated what is called short-time work schemes. It's called chômage partiel or activité partielle in France. It means that you can keep your job and stay home and being paid by the unemployment, but you keep your jobs. So you're temporarily put on hold, but you don't lose your job. In Germany, in 2008, this concerned 1.5 million people, while at the same time, in Spain, all those workers that were on temporary contracts lost their jobs, and the unemployment rate reached 23%, currently in France it's 7%, in a matter of months. So different institutions, different response by countries led to very different impact of a original shock that was similar. So in 2008, Germany and Spain lost the same amount of GDP, but in Germany, the country was ready to start again once the worst part of the crisis was over, whereas Spain took nearly 10 years to recover from that shock. So this time we understood that we had to go coordinated and help those countries that didn't have the means that Germany had to protect their population and to organize solidarity between countries. There was not only we needed money to protect companies, keep them alive, and to keep people in jobs, but we had to collect and access the markets and access money to be able to invest in the economic resilience of our countries. So with this economy stopped, investments don't happen, and important investments that are needed, such as for the green and digital transitions, are also not happening. So we really need to put all forces together, all resources together, to invest in a common EU response with an investment focus. So how do we support the economy with economic institutions? So I ask you to pay a bit of attention because this is a tough slide. It's a little bit, especially if you're not economist by training, but I try to put it in a simple way. So the first thing that EU did was to lift all the barriers that to allow member states themselves to spend as much as needed. That's called the fiscal policy. So you can, with fiscal policy, you can spend public money to support companies, and normally you have a state aid framework in the EU to avoid that member states support companies too much to be able to preserve competition. Because otherwise, in a normal situation, there will be unfair competition because, for instance, France or Germany have deep pockets and can sustain their own enterprises when smaller countries can't sustain to the same level their own companies. So in normal times, we have state aid rules that only allow state aid to companies in certain circumstances. So the first thing was to allow member states to spend all what they wanted to support their companies. They supported their aviation companies, their rail companies, their large companies in the chemical industry, etc. Second thing that EU did to help member states spending as much as needed was to activate what is called the general escape clause. So the general escape clause is putting on hold the Stability and Growth Pact that limits the amount of debt and deficits that member states can have as member of the EU. That means that until now and until the end of 2023, the EU is not controlling anymore the budgets of the member states in the same way as it's doing in normal times. So it was put on hold to say, okay, we need to spend a lot to save and protect our economy, so we are not going to look at debt and deficit for a while. Now, this will stop as of next year and we will start spending. So these two measures, first measures to allow member states to spend as much as needed, were worth 2.4 thousand billions and 330 billions each of the measures. So it was a huge amount of money that was sort of unleashed with this first step. Second thing was to help member states, because member states, not all member states had the money needed to protect their economies. So the second step was to help member states borrow at better rates. Because you know, when you are member states, you don't borrow all at the same rates. For some countries, it's more expensive to borrow and it creates more debt. So we activated the European Stability Mechanism that allowed member states to borrow on the market without making their debt ratios even worse than needed. And we agreed, and that was the first step towards a common EU response to a specific instrument whereby member states could borrow money to activate and finance their short-time work schemes. Short-time work schemes is what I just mentioned before, is the fact that you can stay home without losing your job, or you can work partially without losing your job. Part of your salary is paid by the company according to the hours you still work, and the part that you don't work is paid by a social security system. And by this 100 billion facility, this facility SURE, called SURE, member states could really borrow at very interesting rates to finance those short-time work schemes. So this was a little bit a response to the 2008 mistake whereby Germany had the means and the tools to support their workers and keep them in jobs until better times came, and Spain, millions of people were lost their jobs. So that was the more, the better and more the better and more clever response to the shock, including a solidarity dimension between member states. Third area by which we supported member states and supported the EU economy is to make use of the EU available budget. At the time, a lot of the budget for 2014-2020 period was not spent, and we used we introduced so much flexibility that it was possible to use all the money that was available and spending on fighting the crisis. It was spent on equipment for doctors in the hospitals and the health professionals, and it was spent on different actions that could be co-financed by the regional policy. Another area that is very important to keep the economy functioning and to keep the economy alive is to make sure banks keep lending and buy member state debt. So you need to keep the banking sector alive, because the banking sector is a key actor in the functioning of the economy. So for that, the European Central Bank eased the rules on collaterals and capital of banks to allow them to keep lending to companies so that they wouldn't go bankrupt. And the European Central Bank bought the public and private assets. I mean, very often you hear, but you see, we could find all this money during the crisis. We could only find all this money to spend, the public money to be spent, only because you had all these changes in the EU rules, and we had the European Central Bank sort of guaranteeing the debt of the member states. Without this mechanism, we wouldn't have been able to keep our rating on the markets and keep borrowing money to finance the crisis. So the fact that we could collectively ensure that we had enough money to support our economy was due to the common decision at EU level to allow for this. But we can't go on forever. At some point we have to pay back all this money that we borrowed and we put on the table into the economy. And then another mechanism that was important in keeping the economy alive is allowing to continue lending to the small businesses. And there, a key actor at European level is the European Investment Bank that provides loans with special conditions, especially to SMEs. And it continued and it gave more favorable options for SMEs up to 2 billion euros. Well, it's guarantees, so that is you provide money to a SME and it generates, it gives confidence to other investors that will also invest in the company because they know this SME has the backing of the European Investment Bank. So I think, sorry that to have been a bit technical here and a little bit into economics, but I think it's important. Many people have not seen all this happening because it's happening in the European Central Bank, it's happening on the markets, but it's very tangible. It's what kept our economies alive. And it was much more effective and efficient to do it together than to do it individually at each member state. Because together we have the size of the US, whereas individually we are far behind. Oh. actually doesn't go in the right direction. So this is just to illustrate that all what I explained just before, all these measures that were taken to organize the health crisis, to respond to the health crisis, and to organize the economic response, took place in less than 4 months. As you see, on the 13th of March, the Corona Response Investment Initiative was voted. 13th of March is really the very beginning of the crisis. Huh? 18th of March, the ECB comes into play. 19th of March, state aid came into play. And when we have seen how complex it is to take decisions at EU level, it's quite extraordinary that all this took place so quickly. And so on. Yeah, on 2 April, less than 1 month after, money was put on the table for member states to support their workers and keep them in jobs with the SURE initiative. And this goes on. I will let you go through the timeline and jump to the 18th of May, or to the 23rd of April, when was first discussed the idea to put together the resources not only to face the immediate consequences of the crisis and keeping our economies alive, but to relaunch the economy through a massive recovery and resilience plan. And that's what the European recovery and resilience plan is about. It is, once we have saved our economies, we keep it going, we now have to relaunch it. And not to go back to, because what we did in 2008 was to allow member states to spend money to save the economy at the beginning, but then short after we said, ooh, now we have big holes in our public finance, we have to go back to austerity as quickly as possible. And that killed a bit the recovery at the time. This time there is common understanding that to support the economy and relaunch it and make it stronger, and prepare our very important green and digital transitions, we need more money, even at the time when we have no money left, basically. Because we have spent all this money saving the economy. Most countries have nothing left to spend. We have to still put an effort and put some money more on the table to relaunch the economy. And that's why it's called a recovery and resilience plan. And by 21st of July, we had this historical agreement in the Council, so among heads of states and governments, to borrow together 800 billion euros, almost the size of the 7-year budget, to relaunch the economy. And borrowing together had not been done before. As I explained this earlier today, the way the EU budget is financed is through these very strict rules like national contributions. Borrowing together means that we are getting away from this principle that we finance current policy. It means that we have a common debt together, which is a step further than just putting money in a pot and spending it according to agreed rules. So why it's new? It's because we borrow together and we agree that later we will pay back the loan together in a solidarity form. So it's a major step in the progress in the integration of the European Union. So I think we can say it was a historical agreement, and in terms of size, that's what I just explained. It's about 60% of the 7-year budget. The next generation EU budget is a temporary instrument, so member states agreed, because of the very exceptional circumstances and because of the very exceptional needs, to borrow together. But many member states don't want this to become a habit. So many, it was only, the agreement was only made because very strictly it had to be spent, in fact, engaged within 3 years, to be spent executed on a longer period. But by the end of 2023, we should know what the money will be spent on. So it's really temporary. And then it represents, as I said, approximately 60% of the normal 7-year budget. So that's the second time we see the slide, but maybe it's important that you see it several times so it gets into your head. So you see that the Next Generation EU mainly adds to the second area on cohesion, resilience, and values compared to the standard MFF, means multi-annual financial framework. I'm sorry for this jargon, but this is the EU 7-year budget. And you see that for the cohesion, resilience, and values policies, the money put on the table is nearly doubled. Any questions so far? Did you study economics at all in your journey? No? So I hope I didn't lose you too much with that. So I'll move on. Yes, I was asked to give a little detail on the heading 3, which concerns your area of study more specifically, just to highlight that a bit of additional money will go on environment and climate action and on agriculture, coming from the Next Generation EU budget. Let me just highlight the Just Transition Fund, which is a fund that is specifically targeted at those areas of the EU that will be most affected by the green transition, where you have coal mines, where you have heavy industry, and these are local areas that are well defined and that will receive additional money. So you may ask, where does the money come from, this new money that we have borrowed together? So just a reminder that the long-term budget, this is the four resources from which the source of funding, from which the money comes for the standard long-term budget. It corresponds to approximately 1% of the EU GDP. But how are we going to finance those additional 800 billion? What is important is this time we just don't, as I said, we don't spend the money that we have put in the pocket, in the bucket together that we have, we borrow. And then we will start reimbursing. We can borrow money until 2026, then it stops, and then we will start reimbursing from 2028 until 2058. And therefore, we need to think about ways to reimburse that money. And that's why the Commission is working on a proposal for new own resources based on new proposals on which we have progressed and that are a bit a token of the enhanced cooperation at EU level. Obviously, two of those sources are linked to one of the key objectives of the Next Generation EU, which is the green transition. So we will allocate the proposal. For the moment, it's just a proposal because member states have not yet agreed on these new own resources. That's important to have in mind. But the proposal is to use part of this emission trading system by which polluters, companies that pollute the most, can have to buy rights to pollute. That's an incentive system to do everything to pollute less. Then another source, potential source of income, is the famous carbon border adjustment mechanism, which means that if you are going to ask your companies and tax them on pollution, you should make sure that to reach the carbon neutral goals that we have set up for ourselves, we should make sure that that the money that that the products that we import don't bring carbon back to the continent. So there is a proposal to tax goods when they enter the European Union based on the amount of carbon they have used to be produced. Then the next source envisaged is the tax on multinational companies. It's a project launched by the OECD by which the EU is trying to is reaching an agreement to ensure that companies pay at least 15% of tax wherever they operate. For the moment, tax evasion does that many companies, large companies, don't pay tax in the EU or pay taxes where it's lowest in the EU, even though they operate in all countries. So wherever you operate, we will have each company, well, large companies will have to pay at least 15% tax. So that's the size of the project, and we estimate that it will have an important growth impact of between 0.7 or 1.2% of GDP by 2026 to the EU. So the orange line is the size or the growth effect of individual member state plan, and the blue line is what the common response adds to the national plans. So you see it's a significant impact in terms of economic growth. And here you have a view at national level. And what is interesting to highlight is that the plan, the recovery plan, the additional money that you put in your economy, in your member state, also using the Next Generation EU funds, has an impact on your own growth. But because we are so integrated at EU level, we benefit your money, your plan will benefit to your neighbors, and the plan of your neighbor will benefit to you. And so the blue, the light blue part of the chart shows how each member state benefits from their neighbors and from their EU fellows. Luxembourg, being so small, is the one that benefits the most from the others. France is not bad, I mean, because it's really surrounded by many big countries. So it's quite interesting. I think having in mind that this is an illustration of what member states gain from being in the single market. Very often you may hear in the press or in the media that you have net payers to the EU budget and net receivers. That is, there are some countries like Germany or France that put more money in the pot than they receive technically through the budget transfers. But with this slide, it illustrates how much you also gain from the good economic health of your neighbors when you are in a single market. That's called spillover effects. And you see that large countries like France or Germany benefit a lot from as a percentage from being integrated in a single market. So any questions so far? I'm sorry if I'm killing you. I have another 40 minutes to go. No, I have to finish at 6? Yeah, okay. So now what are we talking about in practice? The Recovery and Resilience Facility is the main instrument of this big Next Generation EU plan, and it's supporting national recovery plans with a total budget of 723 billion, which are distributed in grants, so non-repayable, and loans that have to be repaid at some point. So not all countries have an interest in using the loans, because it's only interesting for those countries that borrow at a higher rate on the market than the Commission itself. You have to have in mind that it's the Commission that borrows on the market, issues bonds, and pays back. And countries that currently use loans are typically Italy, Spain, that borrow on much higher rates on the market than the Commission. Just to give you an example, France is not using the loan because its rating still allows it to borrow lower than the Commission or at the same level. So the whole idea of these recovery and resilience plans are to be, first it's a recovery plan, so the money has to arrive in the economy as quickly as possible. So the idea was to be operational on 1st of January 2021. That didn't really happen for all countries, we'll see. And that the budget is committed by the end of 2023, of which 70% before end 2022. This is really the recovery part of the idea, that is to be able to support the economy when it starts again, the money has to flow in quickly. And implementation has to be finalized before 2026. The idea is that implementing Next Generation EU could generate 2% of additional GDP by 2024 and create 2 million jobs. It's only afterwards that we will check, that we will see if this is true, but it's clear that compared to the 2008 crisis, the 21 and 22 were years of much better economic growth than could have been expected. There has been a clear recovery impact of those plans. I don't know why it's going the other way. But, sorry. So now again, I require a bit of your attention because this is quite important to understand the nature of those plans. When I talked about regional policy before, it's mainly grants that are given to build bridges, to finance training programs, actually concrete things for which the member state presents a bill and the Commission pays. So this instrument is very different because one, it combines investments and reforms. I have not detailed this, but what is important in the effectiveness of a recovery plan is that the institutions and the policies that are in the member states allow those this money to be effectively and efficiently used. So that's why we're asking both reforms and investments. That's also the result of the deal at the council, because you have part of the countries who wanted money, the others said okay to give money to those who are in difficulties, but then we need them to reform their labor markets, to reform their institutions, etc., so that they are better performing countries and we all benefit together. So this instrument combines investments and reforms, and the reforms are based on what we call country-specific recommendations that are addressed to the member states every year depending on their specific economic challenges. So for instance, we're going to ask a country to adopt a tax reform, to reform its pension system, to reform their unemployment benefit system, to improve the quality of its healthcare, to invest more in environmental, in renewable energy, depending on the challenge, or to simplify its institutions, its judicial institutions, etc. So this is an important part because it's a tool to relaunch the economy, to invest in the future of the green and digital transition, and to make the countries more resilient. And the economies are more resilient with better institutions, so through reforms. Overall, the expected impact is to strengthen the growth potential of the member states and job creation and improve the social resilience too. The way it works is that the member states present their plans, it's assessed by the Commission, and it's approved by the European Council of the European Union, as we saw before. So the way it works is that the money is disbursed by tranches up to twice a year according to an agreed schedule of milestones and targets. So contrary to the structural funds or to the regional policy that we discussed earlier, we don't pay against the bill. We pay against achievement of certain results that are materialized by milestones for reforms and targets. So the first payment of France, for instance, was made in March last year because France did a number of reforms, notably climate and resilience law, the reform of its public finances, and the reform of unemployment benefits, and the reform of health and safety at work. Spain, for instance, did a major labor market reform. So you have to do certain number of reforms and realize a number of investments. So a lot of the investments in France concern, I will come back to it, concern, for instance, the energy renovation of buildings, and other things like that. So milestones are qualitative and refer to the adoption of a reform, and targets are quantitative and typically refer to investment. For instance, the number of buildings renovated, number of trainings provided, kilometers of rail tracks built or renovated, etc. We just check that these things happen, but we don't necessarily ask for the bills to prove that the money was spent. At some point, auditors may come and ask for the bills, but to pay, we don't need to see the bills. So once we have checked that member states have done what they promised to do, we propose to the Council, of the European Union, to pay the tranche that was foreseen. For instance, the first tranche for France was 7 billion, the next one is 12, etc. If some of the milestones or targets foreseen for this specific tranche is not fulfilled, we'd reduce the amount of the payment. according to an agreed method. So it's not proportional to the money not spent, but it's proportional to the importance of the milestones and targets in the plan. Is it clear to you? And it's a bit technical, but it's quite important. The philosophy is very different. It's really you want these investments to be transformative and prepare for the future. So how is the money allocated between member states? So for the grants, 70% of the total allocated was allocated in function of the size of the population, of the inverse of the GDP per capita. So poor countries get more. It's not bigger countries get more. Or a richer country gets more, it's poor countries get more. That's why we look at the inverse of the GDP per capita. And we also look at the unemployment rate. Because at the time when we signed the agreement on this facility, we didn't have data on the actual impact of the COVID crisis. So we used the data that was available, and that's why last year, in June 22, we revised the allocation to take into account the actual impact of the crisis. That's why, so for instance, the allocation for France was reduced, because France did quite well in the recovery. So the impact of the crisis in France was less than expected, so it's getting less money after all. Whereas in Spain and Italy, it was worse than expected, so they will get even more money. The loans, worth 386 billion, they are available on request, but no country can borrow more than 6.8% of its GDP. And all this has to be requested before August 2023. So that's a slide that I put for you, especially because I didn't find it on the material. And you can see the different size of the plan, both in grants and in loans, expressed also in they are ranked in function of their percentage of GDP. So relative to the size of their economy, those countries that get most are Greece, Spain, Romania, and Italy, followed by some member states, Eastern member states, and Portugal. So we have a bit this cohesion policy idea or principle that we see a little bit, again, the map that we have seen on cohesion policy, on regional policy before, where the poorer countries get more. And then you can see which countries have asked for loans, and you can see it's mainly the poorer countries that have an interest in using loans, simply because they borrow more, they have a more expensive rate on the market to borrow money. So now maybe I will skip this a little bit because I don't want to kill you completely. This is the process to adopt the plan, just to show you how serious it is. The member state submits their plan. Within 2 months, the commission is analyzing the plan, and I can tell you at the time I analyzed the plans of Spain and Malta, it was a bit of a day and night work to analyze whether what the country was proposing was actually ambitious, whether it was in line with the recommendations that it had in terms of reforms, and whether and I'll come back to that, whether the investment proposed were in line with the objectives of the EU. Then once the commission has analyzed the plans, I can also do it. Once the commission has finalized the analysis and produces SWD is a staff working document. It's a document that explains what the commission has done, in detail. Then the council looks at it, so the Council of the European Union, and approves formally the plan. So each national plan is analyzed by the Commission and is approved by the other member states together. So all this money borrowed together, everybody in the team has the right to look at what the others are doing and whether they are going to do it well. And once the plan is formally approved, automatically the member state starts receiving money, pre-financing. This is in the with the idea that money has to flow into the economy as quickly as possible because it's a recovery plan. Then, once the plan is approved, when we progress in the implementation, we come to the first tranche and the first payment request, the first money that is actually paid against milestones and targets that have been fulfilled. Again, we have a process whereby the member state up to twice a year requests the disbursement of the fund and providing the proof that it has reached what he has committed to. So he has to show that he has adopted reforms, he shows that he has invested. For France, for instance, we screened and we looked in details at all the legal text of the reforms to check if they were in conformity with what was described in the plan. And we checked, for instance, France supporting, we support the EU MaPrimeRénov', we support Un Jeune, Une Solution. So we checked contracts of hiring subsidies of apprentices. We checked lots of documents like this to make sure that France had done what he had promised to do. Again, within 2 months, we had to do that. And then we gave our okay. And once we give our okay, we send it again to the member states, to the Economic and Financial Committee, so not the council, but a committee below it, a technical committee, that approves. So really also, every time we pay money to a member state within this plan, we have an approval by all the member states. Then another thing happened, another major crisis, the Russian war against Ukraine. Remember what happened? Energy crisis. And that I think everybody remembers, I don't need to explain. That suddenly the EU realized that it was far too dependent on Russian oil and gas. So there was an immediate need to react to that, to break this dependency on Russian oil and gas. Again, we have an acceleration of the integration. Suddenly there is a massive threat, a massive problem that we have to, that is very clear we will deal better together than independently. And that's why we organized a very, very fast plan to move from a continent depending on our Russian oil and gas and on oil and gas in general and fossil fuels in general and become independent of this. That is, why do we need to become independent of Russian oil and gas? Because it puts in danger our sovereignty on our capacity to support our economy and make our economy function properly. So what was the response? Is a new initiative that is called Repower EU, where the objective was to reduce our dependency on Russian fossil fuels and accelerate our transition to a low carbon economy. Because the best way not to depend on Russia but also on other unreliable partners, unfortunately, those partners that have most oil and gas and most fossil fuels are not the most reliable of partners. So we have to find ways to reduce our dependency on fossil fuels altogether, and to diversify our sources of supply so that we don't only depend too massively on one single partner, but we depend on several partners in the world, and preferably those that are like-minded, those that are less likely to become our adversary in a bad sense. So that was the plan. Diversify our sources of supply, save energy, produce clean energy, because to replace fossil fuels, we have to produce more clean energy. So we have to invest as a continent massively in renewables, sustainable biomethane, and fossil-free hydrogen. And what is important is all the steps we are going to do to make it possible, because there are a lot of barriers to all these investments. I mean, electricity grids are not adapted to, you have to adjust your infrastructure, you have to invest in electricity storage, you have to organize the value chains in critical raw materials that are used in building, for instance, the windmills or the solar panels. And then we need to also invest in the skills that will allow us this massive change in our energy mix in Europe. So we need to train engineers, technicians that will be able to work with building renewable energy, in research in production of hydrogen, etc., etc. Another thing that we have to address as a continent is to make sure that our citizens don't suffer too much from the transition. And we know in France with these gilets jaunes that whenever there is a pressure on the cost of energy, there is a social risk, and we need to protect those people that will need time to adjust to the new situation. So once again, the member state tried to find money to put together to support this big investment. And they decided to use the Recovery and Resilience Facility as an instrument to organize the investments and reforms of this Repower EU initiatives. So there will be new Repower EU chapters in the national plans that I just mentioned, with a bit of additional money using the unused loans, but also adding 20 billion more grants from the EU emission trading system that I already mentioned. So I will accelerate a bit. Just to show you the state of implementation, so that's the state of play. To date, we have spent 150 billion already to the member states. It's a bit less than we expected because we have had some difficulties. As you can see, we have now 27 plans adopted, but there are still 7 countries that have not asked for money yet. While some of the plans are a bit stuck, like Hungary and Poland, because we have some rules for spending this money that have to do with rule of law or do no significant harm, I will show you afterwards. So some countries are not in a hurry to ask for this money because they don't need it. That's Finland, Sweden, Netherlands, but others are in a hurry but are not complying with the rules. So it takes time. At the other end, you have countries like Italy or Spain that have already received 3 times money, and where the plan is advancing well. France has had received money once and will prepare a second payment request by probably by June. So this is just for your information, because now I spoke a lot about the process and the way it works, but I didn't tell you what the money is used for. And what is important to have in mind, and I think this you should note down, is that 30% at least of the money has to be spent in the green transition, and there is a green tagging. So every measure in each plan is tagged 100% green or 40% green or not green at all, and 20% of the plans have to be spent in the digital transformation of the economy, and again each measure in the plan is tagged 100% contributing to the digital transformation, 40% or 0%. So I will come back, because this is quite heavy, but the type of measures that are financed in the area, maybe I'm going back on this because it's too heavy like this. So as I was mentioning, there are green and digital target of 30% and 20% minimum. The good news is that when we analyze all the plans, we reached 40% of the expenditure on contributing to climate change, and 26% to the digital transformation. So member states have been good pupils on that front, which is good news, because we really want this plan to contribute to the green and digital transitions. So the type of an analysis of the plan shows that in the area of green transition, around 40% of the total allocation went to climate tagged measures, and 43% to, broadly to green measures in, overall. The type of investment that are seen for the green transition are, for instance, sustainable mobility, renovation and energy efficiency, clean power, biodiversity and climate adaptation. I've heard that some of you work on environment and climate adaptation. I don't know exactly the title of your program, but you see that some of EU money goes into that. A lot of investments, 16 billion in the circular economy and sustainable water, and 13 billion in the green R&D and innovation. The types of reforms that are included in the plan is reforms to promote either general reforms like the climate and resilience law in France, or specific reforms to promote intermodality and tax incentives for clean vehicles, reforms to facilitate the deployment of renewable energy. For instance, one of the big barriers to adopting renewable energy is the permitting. It takes up to 10 years to have an agreement to build windmills in France, when in other countries it takes 1 year. So there are really things to be done reforms to be done to accelerate the deployment of renewable energy. Recently, France has adopted a law in this direction. When you have reforms about water and waste management and permitting, I just explained. Quite importantly, we have quite a lot of, we have a significant share of cross-border projects that necessitate, by their size and complexity, to have more than one country involved. And that concerns the big railway corridors that EU has been investing in for years, investment in the production of hydrogen and of batteries. Then I want to stop with the DNSH, which means do no significant harm, which means that no measure in the plan harms the environmental objective. So this is very important because we cannot finance with the EU money investment that would be harmful for the environment. So that's another important aspect. This is another view. You can see a lot of the big main areas of investments in the area of climate tracking is sustainable mobility, so cars, clean transport, railways, waterways, energy efficiency. A huge part of the plans concern the renovation of buildings and making factories more energy efficient, decarbonization and all this. And then investment in the renewable energy and networks. So it is a green plan. It's really a plan to support the greening of the economy. Another big area is the digital transition. And then I will speed up again. There we are, we have investments in 5G connectivity, making sure that, that, for instance, in France, we support the installation of fiber over the whole territory, so that broadband connectivity connects all the communes of France. We invest in the digitalization of public administration, in cybersecurity, and in the training of the whole population with digital skills. We have major cross-border projects concerning microelectronics, the cloud, 5G corridors, and very high-capacity submarine cables. Interesting. Again, this is where we invest most in the area of digital. I'll pass, well, I'll skip that. You have to have in mind that a lot of the reforms and investment concern also social and economic resilience. So we have investments in the health system. So for instance, we, with the EU plan, with the French plan, we renovate hospitals. We have a reform of the health and safety at work. We also have, for some member states, very important labor market reforms to improve the functioning of the labor market. We have reforms and investment in the area of education and skills. We have important reforms of the business environment to make the economy work better. All of that is very important to highlight that there is also a social dimension to these plans. And as a quantification of that, around 28% of the funds support social objectives. And for France, it's nearly 40%. As I mentioned, adoption of these plans may be hampered because some member states don't fully respect the rule of law criteria, which has been added to the EU law that no money can be transferred to countries if the rule of law is not respected. I will not go, currently there are two countries who have a bit difficulties with this, Poland and Hungary. And then this is just to illustrate what this do no significant harm is. It's about climate change mitigation, adaptation, circular economy, etc. But there is really a detailed screening of every measure to make sure that no measure financed by the plan harms the environment. This is a very important dimension because you will see that it means some of the measures proposed by the member states had to be taken out of the plans. The French plan. So you recognize on the picture Mr. Bruno Le Maire, Ursula von der Leyen, the president of the Commission, and at the time Clément Beaune, who was the minister for Europe at the time. And I don't know if you have not heard of the European Recovery Plan, have you heard about France Relance? I hope so, because they did a lot, they do a lot of publicity. The problem is that they don't say that 40% of France Relance is financed by the EU. Notably, Ma Prime Rénov is where you see lots of adverts on the TV, but it's not said that 70% of it is financed by the EU. Un jeune in solution, it's again another 70% of the measures of un jeune in solution are financed by the EU. But the French government is not very good at communicating on this. This is just to explain to you the difference between France Relance and the French plan. So everything that is investments, green and digital investments, training, hiring subsidies, this is refinanced by the EU. As I explained before, there are some investments that may harm the environment that are financed by France Relance, but they could not be refinanced by the EU. Another thing that the EU cannot finance is tax deductions or direct support to companies which are not part of the plan. So, for instance, reduction in taxes for companies who are not part of the European plan. And what is in the European plan but not in France Relance is those reforms that I mentioned earlier. So I will skip. I think I have already given you examples of the reforms that were included in the French plan, notably the law on climate and resilience, the law on mobility, a green budget. France is every year with its budget publishes a green budget, so the amount of money and detail that contributes to the green transition. There is also a law reform of the public finance law, because France has a recommendation from the EU to improve its public finances, and there is notably a law that foresees a long-term to link every budget to a long-term trajectory of reduction of expenditure of responsible budget trajectory, coming back to try to reduce the public debt in France that is around 110 billion euros, 110 billion percent of GDP, which is among the highest in the EU. Key investments that you may have in mind for France is the renovation of public buildings, modernization of the railways, investment in zero carbon hydrogen, and measures in favor of biodiversity. Other investments in the digital transition. Sorry, those slides are in French. I realize I didn't notice that they were in French until now. For instance, we invest in 5G, in the digitalization of public administration, and we finance this plan pour le très haut débit that brings the fiber and broadband connection to all communes in France. Other measures that we finance that will improve the resilience of the economy and of society is this new law to improve the governance of public finance, which I already mentioned. We also finance un jeune une solution and hiring subsidies for apprentices, for youth, training programs, etc. And we also invest in the renovation of hospitals and other health facilities. Now I will finish, I'm almost there. Just one second. you have links. I don't know if you have this presentation you can use to go and see, and I'll show you a little video of I mean on the site you can scan this. You have a map of all the EU projects, not all, examples of EU projects that are financed by the facility. I don't know if it works. Do we have access to internet? Let's see. Yeah. Oops. What do I do with that? Okay. Voilà. Sorry. Okay. Ah no, that's not the right link, sorry. I hope this time it will... So here you have a map that is loading, where you can go and check what the EU is doing, what countries are doing with the EU money. For instance, for France, you can look at specific projects like this. You can click here, and if you click more information, you will find a description of the plan of the program with videos and so on, giving you a bit of a feel of the type of projects that we finance. Voilà. And then in the presentation itself, I have put the links to small videos that show you. For instance, we can try one. Ah, okay, it doesn't want.
C'est impossible de s'imaginer que sans... C'est impossible de s'imaginer que sans ce plan de relance, on aurait pu former autant de conseillers numériques en France.
Des conseillers numériques France Services vise à accompagner, à former les agents recrutés pour lutter contre l'électronisme, pour accompagner les usagers en collectivité, en association, dans leur démarche numérique, en les familiarisant au numérique et à faire du numérique une chance pour tous.
Alors le métier de CNFS en fait c'est de lutter contre l'électronisme. Il faut savoir qu'il y a 17% de la population qui est touchée par ce phénomène. Le conseiller lui vient donc aider ces personnes à appréhender le numérique, parce qu'il faut savoir qu'il y a des personnes qui n'ont jamais touché l'ordinateur.
Un conseiller numérique peut à la fois accompagner directement un senior, par exemple, qui souhaiterait mettre en place une visio Zoom avec sa famille pour maintenir les liens familiaux. Il peut être aussi amené à accompagner, diffuser, sensibiliser auprès d'un public adolescent, des enjeux de sécurité, de risque aussi, des usages de l'Internet, jusqu'à même accompagner des PME dans l'intégration des enjeux numériques, dans leur fonctionnement, dans leur développement.
Les conseillers numériques sont principalement dans des collectivités ou des agglomérations. On les retrouve aussi dans des associations ou aussi des centres sociaux. Il y a tout type de profils chez les apprenants, des profils qui ont déjà baigné peut-être dans le milieu du numérique et des profils qui n'ont pas du tout baigné dans le domaine du numérique. Justement, la formation, elle les aide aussi pour pouvoir accompagner des personnes, pour que les personnes, en tout cas, deviennent autonomes
sur leurs usages.
Ce qui me plaît le plus, c'est la rencontre justement de personnes. Il y a une vraie diversification, soit on rencontre des usagers, on rencontre de tout, des jeunes, des moins jeunes, des personnes avec plus ou moins de difficultés. C'est le côté humain qui me plaît beaucoup.
Ce plan de relance a permis pour PopSchool de déployer ses formations d'accompagnement sur une grande partie du territoire national en lançant 32 sessions qui sont arrivées à échéance au mois de juin 2022 et pour avoir formé 337 conseillers numériques France Services à ce jour. Le dispositif d'accompagnement à la formation des conseillers numériques France Services représente une enveloppe approximative d'1,2 million d'euros pour Pop School et le financement au terme du plan de relance européen représente 50% de ce dispositif.
That's where I want to finish. So I mean, these small videos we are trying to do with our small means to show that EU supports very concrete projects on the ground that contribute to this green and to this recovery and green and digital transitions. I hope that now, next time you are asked whether you know about the European plan, recovery plan. You would say yes. Thank you very much for your attention.